A very good morning to all of you from the city of Ahmedabad in India. And yesterday I introduced the basic concept how the atmospheric chemistry and climate change are interrelated, the feedback mechanism as well as the direct impact from the atmospheric chemistry on the climate change. So I would like to address on some of the specific constituents which are important in the atmosphere. So one of the constituents which is very important are the carbonaceous aerosols, which are certainly largely due to the man-made activities. So I will try to first give you the broad the concepts and the issues which are important in the present day concept. So yesterday I was trying to address this basic fact that the anthropogenic aerosols are in the size range of some micron to micrometer size range, and they are composed of numerous inorganic and organic species. And I also stated that we have three broad categories. First one is the sulfate, and then comes the carbonaceous aerosol, and in which we are talking about the black carbon and the organic carbon. So these two species put together are known as the carbonaceous aerosol. And then we have the dust as the perennial constituent in the atmosphere. And this has substantially increased the global aerosol burden from the pre-industrial time to the present day. So that means in the last 100-200 years, man has significantly contributed to the anthropogenic activities and increasing the atmospheric burden of carbonaceous aerosols, sulfates, and dust. So in this talk today, I will basically address the issue of the carbonaceous aerosols. What are the issues which we are related with the climate, and what are the climate significance? Now, black carbon, the so-called, which is comes from fossil fuel, biomass burning, coal burning. These are all important sources which are contributing to black carbon in the atmosphere. And black carbon is considered as the most is the potential warming agent in the atmosphere, or the species in the atmosphere next to carbon dioxide. So this is a very clear understanding that the just like we have the greenhouse gases warming there due to carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and the other halocarbons, which I briefly addressed yesterday. So next to carbon dioxide, the warming agent is the black carbon. And of course, organic carbon, I will address the issue about the organic carbon, which are scattering particles, so they reflect the solar radiation. So what are the climate significance of that? So let us try to understand the thermochemical classification and the molecular structure and the optical classification. So the recent issues which are very important in the black carbon and so-called brown carbon, which also I will address in this particular talk, and the light absorbing aerosols. So light absorbing aerosols are nothing but the black carbon and the brown carbon. I will come to the black carbon on the brown carbon when I address the specific the issue which is there with the brown carbon. So brown carbon is mostly organic and water soluble. This one has to keep in mind. And the source of this brown carbon is mainly the biomass burning smoke. So this is the constituent which is also important in the atmosphere, which also absorbs the light, which I'll try to address that issue in addition to the black carbon. Whereas the organic carbon, which you see here in this particular context, you can see that the organic carbon is mainly the refractory type. So what is the classification which you see here is the elemental carbon, which is the thermochemical classification. So whenever the black carbon or the elemental carbon is measured by thermo the method or the chemical method, it is referred as the elemental carbon. And the molecular structure of black carbon or elemental carbon, which you can loosely refer to that, are the graphene layers or the graphite. And the optical classification is the only way when you talk about the black carbon. So there is a small difference between how you address the elemental carbon and the black carbon. So there are small differences in the morphological feature, which I will try to address here. Then we have the refractory organics, which are nothing but the polycyclic, aromatic, and the humic substances. And these are form the particular class of organics. And these are mainly colored organic compounds. Then the third class is the organics, which are low molecular weight hydrocarbons and the derivatives of the carbolic acids. And these are colorless organic carbons. So this is the class which we talk about, the organic carbon, which also comes from the biomass burning and the fossil fuel emissions. So this is the one class of organic carbon, which is mainly refractory, the colored in nature, as well as the scattering type of species. So we have the black carbon, which is absorbing type of species. So you can see the morphological differences in the black carbon or the elemental carbon. Now, black carbon, yesterday also I tried to address this issue that the black carbon is a surrogate of the soot particle. So this is a long chain soot particle, which you can see that black carbon is one of the way you refer to the carbon of the long chain the soot particle. So whenever you say the soot particle, the soot particles are measured by optical method as the black carbon, whereas this is the typical amorphous carbon sphere which comes from the coal burning or from the biomass burning. So there are morphological differences in the black carbon which comes from the biomass burning or forest fires or coal burning, and the soot particles which come from the fossil fuel emission. So this demarcation you have to keep in mind for understanding the climatic significance of the black carbon, brown carbon, and the organic carbon. So some of the organic carbon, that means it is of absorbing type, which we are referring as the brown carbon. But other organic carbon is the scattering type. So the absorption of the brown carbon increases much steeper toward the lower UV region. So this is what the new concept which has emerged in the atmospheric chemistry, that in addition to the black carbon, which is absorbing the species next to carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, you also have the brown carbon in the atmosphere, which is also absorbing species. So that means we are talking about the greenhouse gases absorption, and then we are talking about the black carbon absorption and the brown carbon absorption. The rest of the all aerosols, as yesterday I tried to explain, are most of them are having a cooling effect. So we have quite a complex scenario in the atmosphere, where you see that the carbon species are absorbing type as well as the scattering type. So this is the basic concept which I want to address in this particular talk. So now the question which comes is that what is the global annual emission of black carbon? So it is of the order of 8 teragrams. And teragrams is translates to 12 grams. So the black carbon emissions are mainly coming from biofuels, about 20%. Then you have fossil fuels, which are 40%. The fossil fuel has all the fuels which we are using, including the coal and the petrol and the other the petroleum products. So fossil fuel constitutes all those sources which are being used as the fuels. So 40% comes from the fossil fuels, and open biomass burning, which is forest fires, agriculture waste burning, and all other type of vegetation constitutes about 40%. So this is a very major source of black carbon in the atmosphere. But nevertheless, keep in mind that the black carbon coming from open biomass burning or coal burning and fossil fuel have a different morphological feature. So the response in the atmospheric chemistry and the response in the climatic scenario are somewhat different. So this is a very important aspect we have to keep in mind. So, but nevertheless, the uncertainty is very large. Uncertainty is of the order of 2 to 5 on a regional scale, and and almost like 50% on a global scale. So this is a very, very difficult situation. Because if you have to understand the climatic significance of black carbon, brown carbon, and organic carbon, how do we understand the then the complexity because of this large uncertainty factor on the regional scale as well as on a global scale. So what do we try to do? So I will try to address that particular issue also. So what comes is now let us try to in a very basic way try to understand how does the soot particle behave as a warming constituent or a warming agent in the atmosphere. So soot particles, which is black carbon, which I explained, that the black carbon is measured as a surrogate of a soot particle. So whenever you want to measure the concentration of soot particles in the atmosphere, you have to do the optical method, and by optical method you do the you measure the black carbon, and whenever you do the thermochemical method, then you call the elemental carbon. So there are differences in the definition or the way you try to interpret that. So basically, the soot particles warms the air by absorbing the solar radiation. This is what is important for, as we have understood the concepts in the greenhouse gases. So and this converts the solar radiation into the internal energy. So the solar radiation is absorbed by the black carbon soot particles, and in the process the temperature of the soot particles increases, so raising the temperature of the soot. So when temperature of soot particles increases, the emission occurs at higher temperature, which is the thermal infrared radiation, and this radiation is absorbed by the selectively by the air molecules. So this is a very basic concept which I am trying to address, that how does the black carbon is considered as a warming agent in the atmosphere. So this is a very simple way that you have the solar radiation absorbed by the soot, and then it emits and the air molecules are heated with that. So then what happens? So the warmer air molecules have a long lifetime because they can go the long range transport. So you can heat the atmosphere on a more spatial scale by this process. So this is a basic concept which is important. Now it is also important that what happens during the daytime. So daytime, the soot particles absorb solar radiation, obviously, and they prevent the radiation from reaching the ground. This is something which is important. So whatever the soot particles which are there in the atmosphere, lower atmosphere, they are absorbing the solar radiation. So that means solar radiation does not reach the ground. So as a result, there is a cooling on the ground. So during the daytime, because you don't get the radiation. So that means if you put a lot of black carbon in the atmosphere, you may cool the ground. Because all the radiation is absorbed by the soot particles. Okay, then what is the scenario during the daytime? So daytime, what happens? The soot or the black carbon absorbs the Earth's thermal radiation, and portion of which is redirected back to the ground. So that means this is something which is very important, that during day night also, during night also, what happens? There's the portion of that that infrared radiation is redirected back to the ground. So you have the warming of the Earth's surface. So it's a very, very simple understanding. But this is what happens if you have the black carbon soot particles in the atmosphere. Okay. So what we have understood so far, that the soot particles create three major types of temperature gradients. During daytime, atmosphere warms because the air molecules are heated because of the absorption of the soot particles, and those are emitted to the air molecule. Air molecules get heated up, so atmosphere gets warmed up. Ground cools because the radiation is not reaching to the ground. The second aspect is the nighttime gradient. Then the atmosphere warms because obviously the air the radiation from the soot particles is warming the air molecules. So atmosphere, but ground also warms because some of the radiation which is absorbed by the black particles is redirected back to the ground. So ground is warming. So this is very important, the daytime gradient, nighttime gradient, and there is a large scale day night gradient because of the presence of the air which is heated by the soot. So warm atmosphere so is there because of the heating from the soot particles. So you have large scale day night gradient. So this is a simple concept one has to keep in mind. How does the black carbon or the soot particles are considered as the warming agent in the Earth's atmosphere? Okay, so then the question comes is that as yesterday we discussed that what are the atmospheric radiative forcing effects of the aerosol. So today we are trying to address what is the atmospheric radiative forcing of the carbonaceous aerosols, and I will talk about the dust also, that how does the dust have the atmospheric radiative forcing. So today we are trying to concentrate only on the carbonaceous aerosol. So modeling studies which are being done, because the observations are not many, so modeling studies are done, and these modeling studies are, they use the predicted OC by EC ratio. Now OC is the organic carbon, you have to keep in mind, which I address in the first two slides, that what is organic carbon. These are colored compounds, scattering type, low molecular weight, high molecular weight compounds, and these are basically the primary also as well as secondary also. So some of the volatile organic carbon also gets converted to the organic carbon, and these are then called secondary organic carbons. And we also have the primary organic carbon, which comes from the biomass burning. So like what we have there in northern India. But nevertheless, the important thing is that when modeling studies are made with respect to the atmospheric radiative forcing, they use some kind of predicted OC by EC based on the emission sources. This is something which you have to keep in mind, that there are emission sources, well-defined emission sources are known. So people try to use the emission sources and calculate some based on some emission factors, the fuel consumption and the corresponding emission factors. So they get some OC by EC ratio, and that is put in the model, which I will not go into detail. But this is the based on the prediction. Because emission sources are taken on a local basis, global scales, but there are large uncertainty, which I addressed in the first two slides. So this is subject to the significant uncertainties. This is very important. So that's why the modeling studies have to be refined through the direct measurements through the network of stations. So this is a very basic requirement, because aerosols, when we are talking about understanding the climatic significance of the aerosol, we have to rely on the direct measurement through network of stations, just like we did long back for the greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases also were measured at several stations, and that is how we understand the global warming because of the greenhouse gases. So there is a very dire need for the direct measurement through the network of stations. So I will give one example of what has been done in the Indian context. This is the Modi's image, and what you see here is the thick haze advecting eastward into the Bay of Bengal. So this is the Indo-Gangetic Plain. This is the upper part of the Indo-Gangetic Plain. And then we had some studies made at Hisar, Kanpur, Allahabad, and Jharkhanda, and Kharagpur. And finally, all this haze enters into the Bay of Bengal. But this happens during the winter time, because winter time the boundary layer dynamics are very important. Boundary layer comes down. All the pollutants are trapped in the lower atmosphere, including the black carbon, organic carbon, sulfates, and all kinds of pollutants which are there. And these are being added, as most of you know, are coming from the fossil fuel emissions as well as from biomass burning emission. And as a reference station, we had this Manora peak also, which is at 2,200 meter altitude. So one can see that how the things are escaping from the boundary layer, because this is much above the boundary layer height in the Indo-Gangetic Plain. So this is what the type of measurement which the modeling studies need, and that's why the efforts are going on and were made in the last 10-15 years to get the direct measurements from some of these sites which are very heavily polluted. You don't have much of this biomass burning emission in southern part of India. There the dust is more important, except that the fossil fuel emissions are important all over the subcontinent. So that is something which I try to give as an example. So now the basic point which I made is that during the winter time, emission from the post harvest agriculture waste burning, which was the burning issue in the last week, 10 days or 2 days, because National Capital of India was getting too much of smog conditions, and that is because of the downwind transport of the pollutants from the post-harvest agriculture waste burning and the fossil fuel combustion, which is there around the year, because fossil fuels are used by the uh, uh, by, by human beings, so it is continuously. And the wood fuel, which is used for domestic heating during the daytime or during the winter time, sorry. So this is something which is very important. So during winter time, emission from post-harvest agriculture waste burning, fossil fuel combustion, and wood fuel domestic heating is very, very strong. So this results in the enormous amount of organic carbon and elemental carbon being put into the atmosphere. So when you, in a short period of 2 months, 3 months, if you put so much of organic carbon into the atmosphere or the elemental carbon in the atmosphere, this is going to modify the total particulate carbon content of the atmosphere. That means it is also going to modify the atmospheric chemistry of the atmosphere. The significant part of northern India. So this is where the chemistry is important. So we have to know the composition of the black carbon, whether it is soot particles, whether those are coming from the biomass burning, coal burning, and the organic carbons which are primary and secondary, which I have been trying to address both ways. And I'll talk about the brown carbon, which is part of the organic carbon, but it is also an absorbing species. So such a tremendous load into the atmosphere is definitely important for the atmospheric chemistry. And hence, since atmospheric chemistry and climate or the regional climate are interrelated, so one has to worry about how we understand this, the concept of putting so much of carbon into the atmosphere. So what happens is the big picture which we have got from these studies is that what I'm trying to illustrate in a very simple way. If you look at the OC by EC ratios in the middle of the Indo-Gangetic plain, which is from this region, I'm trying to show some data from here, and I'm trying to show data from the high altitude site, which is Manora Peak. So what happens is that if you see the OC by EC ratio, this is now very important, which was not well understood in the global context as well as in the regional context, that we find that the organic carbon is almost 7 times or 8 times more than the elemental carbon or the black carbon or the soot particles, whichever way you want to refer it to that. So this suggests that we are putting much more organic carbon in the atmosphere than the black carbon. This is very clear, but this has come, this understanding came only because of the direct measurement. Otherwise, you have to take the emission factors and then have some uncertainty. So the direct measurements gave a very clear understanding that in the most of the northern India, we are putting more organic carbon than the black carbon in the atmosphere. So if this is the case, then higher ratio suggests that the dominance of the scattering organic carbon in the atmosphere than the absorbing BC or EC. I keep using the terms in a loose way, because either you can call it EC or BC. So this is a very significant result, and this understanding came in the last 10 years when the direct measurements were done through our efforts funded through the ESRO organization in the geosphere biosphere program. So this was a very important understanding. So if this understanding is there, that means the scattering coefficient of organic carbon have to be used or to be considered in the regional scale climatic model, because people are not using this scattering component. They are just putting the black carbon as the absorbing species, running the models, and then finally trying to predict that what will be the heating because of the black carbon. But the organic carbon is to large extent is neglected. But now models are getting refined, and they are using trying to use the OC by EC ratio, so the scattering component of such a dominant source is also put into the models. So this understanding is very important, and that's why I'm trying to emphasize more on the measurements or the direct measurements. Okay, so once this has been understood, so this is a comparison to show you that if you look at the South Asian region, what are the different organic or the elemental carbon which is shown by the black bar diagram, and then the OC by EC ratios are shown by this color, and the yellow color represents the organic carbon. So you can see that in most of the Asian regions, some of the in Dhaka or over the Indian Ocean or Lahore, you can see that most of the time except Mumbai, you can see that the OC by EC ratio is very close to 2, Now, ratio of 2 or 3 is considered as the organic carbon or black carbon, which is driven by the fossil fuel emission. So, if you go to the urban city, or if you go to urban region or the metro cities, you must have a very lower OC/BEs. This is a simple understanding, because you have very less organic carbon, but you have more of black carbon coming from the fossil fuel. But by and large, you can see that the place in Bangladesh where the ratios are very low, but the otherwise the ratios are much higher. That means the most of the Southeast Asian regions, the OC/EC ratio is significantly higher compared to the black carbon. So the black carbon and the organic carbon are not comparable. Actually, the organic carbon is much higher compared to the black carbon. So this is a very important scenario. That we have to use the OC/BC ratio in the models, and not only just the BC concentration, which people measure either by optical method or by the thermochemical method. So this scenario is something which I am trying to share, that the in most of the Southeast Asian region we do have a very strong component of organic carbon being put into the atmosphere. So this understanding comes again as of the direct measurement, because the models have to use the direct measurement and then try to use the emission factors and use the emission factors in comparison to that. Okay, so once we understand this, then let us come back to the EC and OC and what is the climatic significance. So it is very simple now, because we know that the organic is a scattering type of particle. So that depends on the relative amounts of the absorbing black carbon, because we have well understood that the black carbon is the absorbing type. The way I tried to explain you in a simple way in the initial slides, that the black carbon is a absorbing species next to the carbon dioxide, and the organic carbon is scattering because of its nature of the particles, both primary as well as the secondary, because they don't absorb, except the brown carbon, which is part of the organic carbon, which I'll talk about. So the warming or cooling of the atmosphere is largely depends on the in the models you have to use relative amounts of absorbing BC and OC. So if the ratio is lower, OC/EC is there, that means they are comparable, then there will be warming effect. Obviously, this is a very simple-minded thinking, that the if that means the when OC and EC are comparable, so that means the black carbon or the elemental carbon becomes more absorbing, so you will have a warming effect, the way we have understood. Then if the ratio is higher, which is what I try to explain you based on the measurements in the northern India, so in northern India the OC/EC ratios are much higher. They are of the order of 7-8. If you there are sometimes even 15 also on a regional scale. But the average picture which I had shown you in this particular slide was the average, because you can see the spread otherwise going up to even more than 10 or even some of the samples which are reaching up to 20 also. That means the organic carbon is much more abundant coming from the biomass burning and the agriculture waste residue. So the EC/OC, so the climatic significance in a very simple minded approach is that it depends largely on the OC/EC ratio, and the higher OC/EC ratio cooling, because they are coming from the same source. This is very 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 important. We are not comparing the two species which are coming from the different sources. These two species are coming from the same source. So if you do any, if you burn the biomass, that you are putting both OC and EC, and depends on it is a wet biomass, because that's why the paddy residue is a wet biomass, so you produce more organic carbon. This is why you have more organic carbon in northern India, because the farmers burn the wet biomass, because paddy crop uses a lot of water. So you use the so when you burn the wet biomass, you produce more organic carbon, and at high temperature you produce black carbon, as happens in the automobile engines, because that is high temperature combustion, so you produce more of black carbon. So that's why whenever there is only fossil fuel emissions, you will see the organic carbon is very small, and the black carbon is very high, soot particles are very high because that is a high temperature combustion. Whereas this is a very crude combustion done by the farmers in the open field, so and wet biomass, so you produce more of organic carbon than the black carbon. So that's why the scenario is very different in northern India during winter time, and the smog formation is largely because of the primary and secondary organic carbon in the atmosphere. This is a well understood concept. Only thing is that some of the mitigation strategies has to be taken or kept in mind, how we try to reduce this the organic carbon component in the atmosphere, because boundary layer comes down, everything is trapped in the lower atmosphere, and that is where it is important to understand the regional climatic scenario. Okay, so let's move on and try to understand now the brown carbon concept, which I would like to address, because it is also an absorbing species, but you will see that the absorption by the brown carbon is much less than compared to the black carbon. But it is an absorbing species. This is very very clear, and this also has come from the laboratory studies as well as from the field measurement that so one of the study which was done by us in recent years was the light absorbing organic aerosols, which also has the brown carbon. So organic aerosols or the brown carbon is a part of the organic aerosol, and I will tell you why the word brown comes, because why it is addressed as the brown carbon. Over the tropical Indian Ocean and impact of biomass burning emission. So we address this issue that in addition to the black carbon which is coming from the biomass burning and getting into the Bay of Bengal, you also have the organic aerosols which is also consist of brown carbon, and how this impact of biomass burning can be understood by looking at both or the three species as the black carbon, elemental carbon, or organic carbon, and the brown carbon. So why the brown carbon concept of absorption has come in the recent years, in the last 10 years, that we, in addition to the scattering type, there is a component at the lower of low molecular weight which absorbs at the lower UV region. So the evidence for this comes for the atmospheric presence of brown carbon comes from three or four different ways. First one is the spectral aerosol light absorption measurements, which are near the specific combustion sources. So if I go and do the measurements near the source region, like in the regions where biomass burning is going on in northern India, and if I do the spectral measurements in absorption measurement, so I can infer, because I know that the absorption is occurring at the lower UV region, so I can understand based on the spectral properties of the absorption by some of these constituents. And this is done also by the observations of the spectral properties of the water extracts of the continental layer. So what we have done in the lab studies, that we extracted the organic carbon or the aerosols which were collected on the filter, extracted with the water, and then did the absorption measurement of the water extract. So we know that the absorption is occurring at the lower UV region. And if you recall, in the very beginning I said that the almost all of the brown carbon is water soluble. This is the statement which is the concept I tried to explain when I was trying to very conceptualize the absorption properties of the black carbon and the brown carbon or the light absorbing carbon. So light absorbing carbon consists of two species. One is the black carbon, other is the brown carbon. But brown carbon is mainly soluble, whereas the black carbon is not soluble in the water. So this is something which you have to keep in mind. So that is how we can derive this information, because we can do the water extract of the continental aerosol, do the spectral measurements at the lower UV region, and we see the absorption spectra, and we try to infer that the how much of brown carbon is there. You can quantify based on the standards also. The third way to look at is again, of course, laboratory studies which are indicating the formation of light absorbing organic matter in the atmosphere. So you can do simulation studies in the lab also by burning some of the plants and then and try to collect that the particles and then measure the absorption. So that is another way the people are trying to do the laboratory studies, which are indicating that this organic matter which is produced has a light absorbing property at the lower UV region. And indirectly, from the chemical analogy of the aerosol species to the colored neutral humic substance. Now, this is the reason why it is called brown carbon. Because if you see the humic acid or the humic substances in the water, for example, if you take the rivers or if you take this sea water where there is a lot of humic substances, so you will see that those are generally of the brown color or a slightly yellowish brown color. So if you match in a very simple way the color comparison, so it is mainly brown color, and this is the reason why it is a colored natural humic substances are present in the aquatic system. So because of that, the absorption spectra also is similar, because if you take the humic acid, which is you can commercially buy and do the absorption measurement in the lower UV region, it will be similar to the brown carbon or so-called species which are dissolved in the water and referred as the brown carbon. So the brown carbon the concept or the terminology comes because of the natural humic substances. So these are nothing but the similar to the natural humic substances. But the important thing is that we are getting this brown carbon in the atmosphere, water soluble it is in nature, and this is largely coming from the biomass burning emissions or from the forest fire emissions and the other wood fuel sources. So this is what the concept, which is very important for the brown carbon. So that means there is another species in the atmosphere in addition to black carbon, which is brown carbon, which is also absorbing type. Okay, so but what is the scenario now? So this is one of the way we try to get the mass absorption efficiency of the brown carbon. So you take the water soluble organic carbon, which I explained in the previous slide. We do the water extract of the samples and then get the water soluble organic carbon. This is the concentration units. And then you do the absorption measurements, and then you see that as the concentration of WOC increases, the absorption coefficient is increasing. Of course, there is a large scatter in the natural samples, which is much expected, because you are dealing with a very complex nature of sample. So, but based on the reliability of the data and the correlations, etc., you can get a slope. And the slope of this line directly gives you the mass absorption efficiency. But keep in mind that the mass absorption efficiency is of the order of 0.70, which is significantly less than the black carbon, because black carbon is around 4 or 5, whereas this is less than 1, I would say that. So, but there are large differences in the mass absorption efficiency of brown carbon. It can go as low as 0.1 or 0.05 also. And it can go as high as close to 1 also, depending on the nature of the water soluble organic compound, which I'll try to address in the next scenario. So this is very important that by doing the water extract of the natural samples collected from the atmosphere, we are able to assess the mass absorption efficiency of brown carbon, just like we very routinely do the mass absorption efficiency of black carbon or the soot particles in the atmosphere by either thermochemical method or by the optical method. So both ways the black carbon is measured, and it's a very standard technique for the black carbon. But brown carbon is something which is very most recent and very intricate issue. But it is important that you have to address this issue, that the brown carbon is also absorbing in the atmosphere. Okay, so if you now look at the this was another the study which was reported a few years ago by our lab, that what are the different comparison which you can do on a seasonal scale, from the Indo-Gangetic plane, because that's where most of these biomass burning emissions are important. So the studies which were reported from that. So I'm just trying to show you a small comparison that if you look at the black carbon, which is the red bars here, you can see that it is almost close to 5 or 3.1, 2. So it varies based on the type of black carbon which you have in the atmosphere coming from the different sources, fossil fuel or biomass or the coal burning and all those things. So this is a very important, but I will not get into detail why the mass absorption efficiency of black carbon is changing, because that is a additional subject to discuss. So, but I'm trying to tell you that the comparison between the brown carbon and the black carbon. So you can say that it is of course small. It's not insignificant, but it is small compared to the mass absorption efficiency of the black carbon. So now if this is the scenario, so that means if I have more of brown carbon in the atmosphere, which is the case in the Indo-Gangetic plane, because a lot of organic carbon is put into the atmosphere in addition to the black carbon. And if the concentration is more, although the mass absorption efficiency is very low compared to the brown carbon, but it will still have an impact, because you are multiplying a bigger mass absorption efficiency with a smaller number, whereas you are multiplying the smaller mass absorption efficiency with a bigger number, because concentration is very high for brown carbon. So this is what I have tried to conclude it here, that the interference of brown carbon with EC and BC measurement. So because brown carbon may severely bias the measurements of the black carbon in the model, because people are still not putting the brown carbon in the model. This is another thing which you have to keep in mind. Just like I was trying to address the organic carbon is now slowly being introduced into the climatic model, because people are trying to use the OC by EC ratio, but still there is no mention of the brown carbon, or there is no way to incorporate the brown carbon in the regional climate models, and which is very important for a place like Northern India, because we have a lot of brown carbon in the atmosphere with a lower mass absorption efficiency, but if you multiply the higher mass concentration with a lower efficiency, you are still going to have a major impact. So the brown carbon may severely bias the measurements of the black carbon and EC over the vast parts of the troposphere, like in Northern India, especially those strongly polluted by the biomass burning emissions. So which is the case in Northern India, we are strongly polluted by biomass burning. So whereas the mass concentration of brown carbon is very high compared to that of the soot carbon. So that means you are already having a bias in the models if you only put the black carbon in the atmosphere and don't consider the brown carbon. So that means the absorption which is being calculated by the models is of the lower order, because brown carbon is also absorbing, because this is the point which I have been trying to make in the last 30-40 minutes, that there is another absorbing agent in the atmosphere compared to black carbon is the brown carbon. And this brown carbon is never being considered in the models. So this is a scenario which one has to keep in mind, how we understand the atmospheric chemistry and how we understand the radiative forcing of the atmosphere. So this concept is slowly evolving, and people are trying to see how to put the brown carbon in the model. Okay. So let me spend about 5 minutes or last couple of minutes on the atmospheric nanoparticle. This concept is also recently now in slowly evolving, and the reason being that the people think that all the atmospheric chemistry is being regulated by the atmospheric nanoparticles. So whatever chemical reactions which you see are happening in the atmosphere are largely because of the nanoparticles. Now, what are these nanoparticles? The spherical equivalent diameter, which is if these are less than 100 nanometer, these are known as the ultra fine particles. And if the equivalent diameter is less than 50 nanometers, then you call it the nanoparticle. So some of the very simple reaction I have written. I don't want to get into too much of details on this chemical reaction. Sodium chloride reacting with the sulfuric acid forming sodium. This happens over the ocean because sulfuric acid, which is coming from the enthalpic sources, also from the biomass burning, from the biomass of the ocean, is reacting with this sea salt sodium, and that is trying to knock off the HCl, which is a very important issue in for the ozone chemistry over the marine boundary layer. So that I will not get into that right now. So, but one of the important reaction is that the NOx or the NO2 reacts with the soot and it forms the intermediate the molecule called HONO, and this is considered as the photolytic source of the OH radical. Keep in mind, which I have not gone into too much detail, because OH is one of the most oxidizing agent in the atmosphere. Anything which you put in the atmosphere gets oxidized by the OH radical. That's how we are surviving on the Earth's radical, because any pollutant which is put in the atmosphere gets oxidized by OH. And if you do not have this oxidation, the life will be very difficult. So one has to very carefully monitor how the OH radical or what is the oxidative capacity of the atmosphere is being regulated. But this is a new source of the photolytic, so which is not again considered in the model, because we know how the OH radical is produced in the atmosphere. So coming back to that, if the nanoparticles, if you take the a very typical urban scenario of a radius or diameter 20 nanometers, and if you take typical concentration of 10 raised to 5 centimeter cube, which is the nanoparticle, so surface area becomes very huge, because 100 micrometers square per centimeter cube of air. This is a very, very large surface area. So that's a very high chemical reactivity, because chemical reactivity depends on the surface area. This we have understood in our high school or in the BSc that the entire the chemical reactivity is governed by the surface area, the availability of the surface area. So the photochemical properties are going to be very very fast because of the high chemical reactivity, as well as the reaction that means changes the composition of the gas phase are also very important on this kind of particles, because the surface area is very, very large. This is what we have understood in our primary area. So reaction rates, moles per meter cube of air at standard conditions, which you see that, so they are almost 10 raised to 13 times as fast as the overall rate in the air parcel. So you have a huge amount of increase in the reaction rate, almost of the order of 10, because of the surface area. So people think that the entire atmospheric chemistry can be redefined now because of the nanoparticles, and these nanoparticles are important. Why they were not important 200 years ago or 100 years ago? Because these nanoparticles are coming largely from the anthropogenic sources. This is very important. In the natural scenario, you don't have the nanoparticles. You have sea salts, you have dust, which are very coarse particles. Nanoparticles are very important now because of the anthropogenic activities. So that's why the entire concept of atmospheric chemistry is being redefined, being re-evaluated based on the nanoparticles. Okay, so what some of the things which are being considered in this nanoparticle, one of the major attention is being given to the reaction between the NOx or the NO2 versus soot, because it is producing this intermediate. And the current models which are estimating the OH radical in the atmosphere, they are not using the intermediate step, because it's very, very difficult also, nevertheless, to how to put this reaction and what is the yield of this reaction to produce the OH radical. But it is very important, because soot is coming from anthropogenic sources now. There's a lot of soot in the atmosphere. NO2 is also coming from the anthropogenic sources as well as from natural sources. So it is very important to see that when HONO is produced, which is the intermediate of the OH radical, is a major source, the photolytic source of OH radical, how does the current models have to incorporate this? Another reaction of the soot with ozone is important, because you are producing some amount of OH. This is again very important, because soot is a complex constituent, as I explained, that it is a long chain hydrocarbon. So you produce a different type of species there, because so, but mainly what happens, you make the soot particle more polar. This is a very important concept, because when soot is reacting with the chemical species in the atmosphere, instead of becoming a non-polar, it becomes a polar compound, and that increases the efficiency of the cloud condensation nuclei, which I was trying to address yesterday, that how the cloud condensation nuclei are having an indirect effect on the cloud albedo, and hence the cooling effect. So now you see, we have come to a very different concept now. So far we were saying that the soot is absorbing species and so on and so forth, but suddenly there is a concept which is important, that if this reaction is important with the soot particles of the ozone, then you can make the soot particle more polar, and since it becomes polar, it will attract moisture, it will attract water, so it will increase their efficiency as the cloud condensation nuclei. That means it will have an indirect effect on the cloud. That means you can have the cloud processing in a different way, as we understand it. So this is a very new concept which is important in the atmospheric chemistry. So you can see that there are more complex things to understand in the atmospheric chemistry in the anthropogenic scenario. So I think at the end, I will touch upon the last concept, which is the atmospheric aging of the soot aerosols, because soot aerosols are staying in the atmosphere for a short time. Nevertheless, the aerosol residence time is no more than a week in the air, but soot particles can travel long distance because of their smaller size. So when they are exposed to the subsaturated sulfuric acid environment, why I am taking this, because this is the scenario which is very true for the endogangetic plane, because we have lot of sulfuric acid in the endogangetic plane because of the heavy industrial large population, large sources there in the endogangetic plane. So if this exposed to the, and soot particles are continuously coming from the fossil fuel biomass sources and other sources, so they, if it is being cooked in the sulfuric acid, which I mean is exposed to the subsaturated sulfuric acid, it may exhibit the marked change in the morphology. You have seen that the long chain hydrocarbon, which I showed in the earlier slides, so the morphology of that long chain compound will change. That means it will decrease the mobility, because you are cooking in the sulfuric acid. You will change the diameter and increase its the effective density. It will become more heavier because of the cooking in the sulfuric acid. So that means this will experience a large hygroscopic size and mass growth and act efficiently as CCM. This is another scenario compared to what I was saying in the previous slide, where the soot particles are becoming polar because of this reaction. But they say aging also is very important, that it experiences the large hygroscopic size, mass growth, and act efficiently as CCM. So that means the optical properties are going to change. So black carbon may not remain as a absorbing species in a high sulfuric acid environment. So this is another atmospheric chemistry scenario, or the climatic scenario, how to take care of the brown carbon or the black carbon, and how the optical properties are going to be measured, because then optical properties are not same as the nascent the black carbon. So this is so that means it is going to become scattering and absorption. This is a big question mark on that, because that changes the optical property. So this is a very complex situation, because we are dealing with the real atmosphere, because we are not sitting in the lab only and saying that we have one species at a time looking at that, because in the atmosphere you have a very complex situation. So I will try to close this today's presentation based on this concept. So the outstanding issues are still there, which any atmospheric chemist in a climate scenario we have to understand. Due to the large spatial and temporal scale variability in the aerosols and cloud properties, this is very important, which we have been discussing in the last couple of minutes. The aerosol radiative forcing is a regional scale issue. This is something which is very important, because radiative forcing, you cannot put it on a global scale because of the diversity of the sources, different type of chemical species and different type of chemical reactions, which I try to some of them share with you that what happens in a real life situation. So what are the export fluxes of aerosols? They are precursors from the continent, mainly from megacities, biomass burning and desert dust. I'll deal with the desert dust in the tomorrow's talk, what happens to the dust, which is a perennial constituent in the atmosphere. And then the last thing which is important is how will the human activities transform the dynamical and chemical properties of the future atmosphere. This is are the outstanding issues. Unless we understand these issues, we cannot really understand the climatic significance of the anthropogenic aerosols and the climate change scenario in it is we can certainly have enhance our understanding on that. So I thank you and for the having a patient hearing of the some of these concepts, and I would like to acknowledge that I had used some of this material from books, research papers, websites, and I am grateful to all the authors who worked with me and some of the other papers which I have used, and very useful material and information which I try to share with you. So thank you very much for your